Let's begin, folks. John, welcome very much. Thank you very much for being with us today. We just switched around some cameras here, but we'll get going in just a second. My name is Steve McClellan. I'm the CEO of the Saskatchewan Chamber of Commerce, and I'm absolutely tickled pink, John, that you're joining us today. I've read your reports and listened to you speak, and now I'm glad you're here with the Saskatchewan members of the Saskatchewan Chamber of Commerce. A couple of things I'll do before we get into the session. I'll overview it in just a second. I want to acknowledge that Saskatchewan Chamber of Commerce work and support reaches lands covered by Treaties 2, 4, 6, 8, 5, and 10, and traditional lands of the Cree, Dakota, Dene, Lakota, Nakota, Salto, as well as the homeland of the Métis people. So we are very committed to Indigenous engagement, and it's worked well, and for our business community, it's also a huge commitment. Now, because we're virtual, there are people in different parts of the country, and I acknowledge that as well, under different treaties and different traditional lands. Thought leadership is a key strategic theme of the Saskatchewan Chamber of Commerce, and we hold a variety of events through the course of the year, including our member hubs for small group discussions with experts and members talking about issues from tourism to labor market, commercial real estate, mental health, and many more issues. That's an ongoing session for us. We welcome the ideas and obviously our members' participation in those sessions. And they are discussions. We limit it to 12 to 15 people. And it's not a webinar, those sessions of the thought leadership. They are indeed a conversation. We also have energy series as part of our overall programming. And obviously, we talk about all elements of the energy sector. We have different papers, different reports, and so on. Now, today is different, and it's also very special. We are with three very special guests with us today. John Stackhouse, who you'll meet in just a moment, is a thought leadership rock star in Canada. He has, I think, taken the RBC thought leadership brand to a height that it's never been at. We'll talk more about that in a few minutes. And one of the reports that they have submitted, they have released, if you will, is Farmer 4.0, which I read a few years ago, and it's brilliant. And if you take out anything that says Canada and agriculture put in Saskatchewan, it fits us very well. It's just one example of the most recent reports. And now we're going to hear in a few minutes about small business big pivot. That's the opportunity today towards a post-COVID recovery. This report was originally released in June, so they're very quick off the draw, and I'm sure there'll be some new insights as we progress. Now, we've got 150 registrants online today, which I'm very happy to see. We've got small business people. We've got educators from the post-secondary to the private education. We've got different business associations. We've got lots of RBC folks, which is great. We've got other financial institutions. We've got industry business leaders, small town representatives, and large city representatives from Lloydminster all the way down to Carlisle and Maple Creek and north. So it's great. We have John, and to the rest of you from afar, had a bit of a snowstorm. A couple of them go through the province in the last few days. So if somebody in Toronto needs some snow, let us know. It'll be shipped to you out of Saskatoon or Maple Creek real quickly. Now, here's a bit of a format for today. We're going to keep you engaged and enthralled until noon, 12 noon our time. And then in a few minutes, I'm going to introduce John, who will give us an overview of the report and the thinking that they have to date. He'll speak for 15 or 20 minutes, or he's our special guest, so as long as he wants. And then we'll go to our panel, and I'll ask each of them, introduce them in just a moment, to do a bit of a quick overview of how they have pivoted, if you will, through that this last very unique time frame. And then we'll have some conversations with the panelists, the two from Saskatchewan, and of course, John as well. And then we'll get into questions for the rest of you. If you have questions, put them into the chat and we'll ask them as time permits, and we'll give lots of time for that because we want to hear what your insight is. As always, the Chamber welcomes your input today and anytime. If you have thoughts of this session afterwards, send them to us. If you have ideas for future sessions, send them to us. And we will endeavor to make sure that we have them put forward for the other members to participate in as well. So again, after we filled you with ideas, facts, and amazing insights, we'll send you back on your way to save the world at about noon today. So get ready, get your Superman Wonder Woman costume ready, because at 12 noon we're going to release you to save the world. Any of you that haven't, that have already done that this morning, you can take the afternoon off, I guess. Now, let me introduce our guests. First, I'll introduce our two Saskatchewan-based guests, and then I'll more formally introduce John, and then we'll turn it to John once again to do his overview. First is Alisha Esmail. She is from Road Coffee in Saskatoon. Nice wave, thank you. Coffee has never been far from founders Alicia's mind. As an integral part of her daily ritual, as it is mine, she's savored for many years at home and throughout the world her travels. Her past work executing development projects in Haiti, Nepal, South Africa set fire to a deep desire to make positive impacts and spark change in an industry that is fraught with turmoil and unethical practices. Blending her passion for ethical business and travel, she saw an opportunity to make a greater impact. She found that in coffee, and founded Road Coffee on the same value she lives every day, connecting passions, people, and values. Road is recognized as a leader in sourcing industry innovations and taste. It's the first to introduce Beyond Fair, a way for farmers to capture more value, grow their business, and benefit the lives of their family and their community. Paying farmers directly and fairly will change the way coffee is grown and sourced and sold. So we will go to her in just a few minutes, but I want to say from Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, Canada, the snow capital of the world, welcome, Alisha. Also from Saskatoon is Shawn Moen. Now, those of you that are realizing you're covered in snow in Saskatoon and you may be out of beer, call 9 Mile Legacy Brewing, see if they can help you. Shawn, after a practicing law for a number of years, he took a leap of faith from professional practice and pivot into the craft beer game. 9 Mile Legacy is truly built on a sense of community and collaborating. During the COVID pandemic, Shawn and the 9 Mile team once again pivoted and shifted much of 9 Mile Legacy's business model by creating a virtual online tap room with a company called Zoo, and have just finished an expansion project that sees 9 Mile Legacy at a second location in Riversdale, which is a part of Saskatoon, a large-scale production facility focused on cans and distribution. You'll hear more from Shawn in just a moment. But now let me go to our guest of honor today. John Stackhouse is the Senior Vice President of RBC. He advises the executive leadership on emerging trends in Canada's economy, providing insights grounded in his travels across the country and around the world. His work focuses on technological change and innovation, examining how successfully people can navigate the new economy so more people can thrive in the age of disruption. Prior to joining RBC, John spent nearly 25 years at the Globe and Mail, where he served as editor-in-chief, editor of Report on Business, and a foreign correspondent in New Delhi, India. Now, having interviewed a range of prominent world leaders and figures, including Vladimir Putin, Kofi Annan, and Benazir Bhutto, he possesses a deep understanding of national and international affairs. He's an author of 4 books, Out of Poverty, Timbit Nation, Mass Disruption, 30 Years on the Front Lines of a Media Revolution, and most recently, Planet Canada, which was just released October 2020. So don't order that last book on Amazon, but buy it for your Christmas list this year. And that new book, of course, examines how Canada's 3 million expats are shaping the world's futures. He's also the host of RBC podcast, The Disruptors. And if you walk or listen to clever conversations, listen to John's, again, the Disruptors. So let me turn it to John to give us an overview of the most recent report and his glance at the world that is post-COVID. John, to you. Welcome, sir.
No, thank you. Thank you so much for that generous introduction and for spending a bit of time with us at RBC today. As we all know, critical questions to begin with. Number one, can you hear me? That's a key question. Yeah. And then secondly, I think your team is going to control the slides that I'll show. I'm going to talk for a little bit about our small business research and then get to slides on where we see the digital transformation particularly going. I'm so genuinely happy to reconnect with people in Saskatchewan and beyond. But my last trip before lockdown in March was to Saskatchewan and Alberta. And I had a great two or three days in Regina and Saskatoon, met with the premier as well as business leaders and a great range of small business entrepreneurs, talking about a lot of exciting prospects as well as the challenges of the world, not knowing what was about to hit us. I'll talk about what did hit us and how that affected small business in Canada and in Saskatchewan, and what we can seize on as opportunities for growth coming out of this, because we are going to come out of this and there is growth ahead, but it's going to be a different kind of economy. And now is a really good time to start thinking about how do we collectively position ourselves for accelerated growth coming out of this. The report that we've published two reports, actually, that I'll refer to today. One is Small Business Big Pivot, which looked at the extraordinary impact that COVID had on small business, much larger than on larger businesses in the spring of this year. And then the second report is looking at eight ways that COVID has disrupted the economy, transformed the economy, and disrupted every business out there, large or small. And we think these insights are really important for business owners, operators, to think about as they think about a new chapter of the economy. When we first published these reports in June, one in five Canadian small businesses had shut down. According to Statistics Canada, the number of businesses in Saskatchewan that closed just in April was double the number that had closed in April the year before. 2,200 roughly small businesses closed in April. And there were moments in late spring where it started to feel like we were heading into another depression. And then government assistance started to pump into the economy in profound ways. And we track consumer spending across the economy. Spending actually went up through the summer. Canadian consumers spent more this summer than they did the summer before. They just spent differently. They spent on, I don't know about golfing in Saskatchewan. It was crazy in Ontario. Golf spending was higher this summer than the summer before. Home repairs, renovations, all higher this year than last year. Home sales, as you've seen across the country, up. A return a little bit to auto sales, a lot of recreation products people bought through the summer. So spending was in some ways better than we had anticipated, better than we expected. And as a result, we saw some small business recovery through the summer and into fall that was a little better than we had anticipated. But as we track this, we see how uneven it is. This is deeply uneven. You often hear of the K-shaped recovery, and that is true for small business. You have some coming out at like a K going straight up, and then some have flatlined and will continue to flatline. We're seeing across the economy that half the job losses out there still are in accommodation and hospitality. Another one quarter are in non-essential retail, and maybe an eighth more are in arts and entertainment. All of those over-indexed to small business. So your members know what the challenges are out there. And when we think about K, you're seeing tech firms really spike up, a lot of service providers spiking up, but those industries, accommodation, hospitality, really, really challenged. Now, this week, we're seeing great news about a vaccine, and everyone has their hopes up, and I really hope we're right in having our hopes up. But it's going to be a grind of a recovery. We're not going to bounce back in any great way. We're still anticipating a grind across the Canadian economy through 2021. And it's going to be uneven. It's not going to be stable. And yes, you've got snow. We know winter is coming. Maybe it's already here. I note the CFIB, the Canadian Federation of Independent Business, has surveyed business owners across the country. But in Saskatchewan, 83% of businesses have reopened. That's good, but only half are fully staffed. And just 32% are making what would be considered normal sales. That speaks to that grind. So doors are opening, lights are going back on, but the money is not flowing to the degree it should. So why does this matter to the country? And we stress this to governments at the provincial and federal level. Small business is the backbone of the economy. That's become a bit of a cliche. But if we want to talk about recovery, we have to talk about it as being powered by small business. 44% of Canadians who work in the private sector this is before the pandemic, 44% work for firms with 100 or fewer employees. So they are employment machines. Small business is a generator of local tax. It is the backbone of many communities. You all know this, but it's also critical demographically. Small business is over-indexed for new Canadian entrepreneurs, for female entrepreneurs, for Indigenous entrepreneurs, for young entrepreneurs. So when we talk about a more inclusive recovery, and a lot of politicians like to talk about this, we're trying to focus them on small business as being a critical way to get at those goals. But we can't get at those goals if we don't understand why small business was so hard hit by COVID. As we show in the Small Business Big Pivot report, Canadian small business was in too many places, in too many sectors, not prepared for this kind of crisis. This was a leap into the future. The future didn't change because of COVID. As we say in our report, it came crashing through our front door. The future is not something off in 2025 now. It is here today. I get to talk to business owners across the country and repeatedly hear about their experiences in seeing what they thought would take 5 years has now changed in 5 months or maybe 5 weeks. So the future is here right in front of us. And small business was not prepared for that. Why? Well, small business typically runs on thin margins in this country, has less liquidity, and has higher fixed costs. Lastly, has a weaker digital strategy, not in all cases by any stretch, but in too many cases. That's something we have to address, and we really stress in our report, because if we are to avoid a K-shaped recovery where too many small businesses are left to flatline, we have to help small businesses and entrepreneurs leap into a much more digitally enabled future. And that means seizing on a bunch of trends that we're seeing really accelerating in the economy. I still can't believe this, but you'll see in our report that coming into this crisis, only 10% of Canadian small businesses were able to process online payments. Only 10%. Half didn't have a really active website. This is according to BDC's research. So these are things that have to change, and we've got to get on to changing these and working with chambers across the country and their members to help make Canada a digitally enabled small business economy. We can do it, but we've got to understand the trends that are on our doorstep. So if I can quickly go through some slides here, I'll speak to the next one about how the future is not something far off. As I said, it is now. We've seen across the economy 8 significant trends that are disrupting every business and disrupting small business particularly. The first one is how we work. We all know that as employees. How we work, which I touch on in the next slide, is profoundly different today than a year ago. Can we just get to the next slide, please? Of course, we all know what it's like to work remotely. There we are, thank you. The challenge now is to help businesses create a hybrid model. And I'm going to come back to that word hybrid a lot because it's critical for businesses and chambers to understand. We're not facing a binary choice where everything is either going to be all online or all in a physical economy. We're going to have what we call the hybrid hustle. And those who figure out the hybrid hustle are going to have a competitive advantage over lots of other actors. That includes how you work as an employer. Your employees, many of them, if not most of them, are working remotely right now. They're very comfortable with that. We're finding that this with our own workforce. 50,000 RBC are shifted to a remote working environment. It's worked really well. Many, if not most of them, don't want to come back, at least not come back full time to an office or a branch. And we're figuring out how do we accommodate them and accommodate our business needs and the demand for more productivity and efficiency in 2021. We think we've got a way to do that, but we're concerned that half the businesses out there, particularly small businesses, are saying they don't have the tech capacity or savvy to create that dual working model, something we've got to take on. Similarly, we've got to work on the next issue, which is how we shop. Critical to small businesses. We're all very comfortable now buying what we want, when we want it, from wherever we want. We're not going back to that. Although we're starting to see the emergence of hybrid models. We made note, as you'll see on this slide this summer, of an explosion of BOPIS, curbside shopping opportunities, which retailers like because it creates more connectivity with their shoppers. But a lot of consumers want that option. They don't want packages sitting on their doorstep. They want to be out for a drive, or they want to go to a store, but maybe not into the store to get what they're looking for. So again, the hybrid hustle is on, but we have to ensure that your members, our clients, and the backbone of the Canadian economy have the digital savvy to reach consumers on their phones, when they want, wherever they want, but then create that hybrid opportunity. So it's not just all through Amazon, as good as Amazon is at what they do. This is also true with anyone in the service economy who provides content to consumers. Speak to slide number 3, how we watch. Of course, we all know about binging. We're all complicit in that. We're watching way more than we ever did. I'm not revealing anything to you there. But one of the things you'll see in our 8 trends report is how we are consuming content increasingly in a very different way. And this is true for younger consumers. They want more interactive content. Gaming has gone through the roof this summer and fall. And it isn't just about video gaming. It is about creating interactive content because people just don't want to sit on their couch watching. They want to lean into content, to be immersed in it, to have the option of augmented and virtual reality, if that's possible, but also have the options of gaming. Traditional content, you'll see with the NHL numbers, which were down for the Stanley Cup, way down, shows just how challenged content providers are. And that's going to be true for local film companies, for local arts companies, for museums, for community groups, as well as for media companies and any corporation that is trying to share content with mass audiences. You need to think about how to create integrated multimedia content and personalized content, which speaks to the 4th trend we're seeing, which is how we share. All that I'm talking about, how we work, how we shop, how we watch, comes down to how we share. What we're doing right now is all about sharing. And that is all about data. We are seeing an explosion of data through this crisis. In the first few months of lockdown, global internet traffic went up 40%. And of all those, hands up, who were part of that. We all know what's happening out there. This is going to lead to an increase in data at current trends by 2025. That will mean there's 10 times as much data out there as there was going into the crisis. And we're trying to stress to small businesses, big businesses too, but small businesses really have to get ahead of this. If you don't have a data strategy, if you don't see data as a competitive differentiator for you, go to sleep at night, but don't go to sleep knowing that your competitors do and the platforms do. The platforms, be it Amazon, Google, Apple, Shopify, all really good companies, but they are data oceans. And they've got machines harvesting this data. And we have to help entrepreneurs develop data strategies so that they can take advantage of this data revolution. This includes travel, which is important to every part of the country and is the 5th big trend we've seen out there, because this is an opportunity. We all know that we're traveling differently. But here's the thing. We as Canadians spend more as tourists outside of Canada than international travelers spend inside of Canada, which means that when the economy is largely sealed and we're not traveling, there is more money sitting around for people to take advantage of when you provide opportunities that are different from what we saw before the crisis. When you provide opportunities for experiential staycations, when you provide opportunities for modest bubble travel within a regional bubble, when you provide opportunities for recreation in a new local environment. This is all creating economic opportunities that we think can be significant for every region of the country. But it's not just about physically going somewhere. It is about meeting consumers and travelers where they are, could be on their phones, could be in their games, when they want. that point of relevance is really critical, and I'll come back to it at the end. Let me talk about the last few trends very quickly and turn it over to discussion. How we heal and how we learn, our healthcare and our education, critical in Saskatchewan, are really good in this country. We have arguably the best healthcare system, or among the best healthcare systems, and among the best education systems, K to PhD, in the world. We have great health providers, great teachers. Our system is not as good as it could be. And we should look at COVID as an opportunity and a mirror in a way to see where our inefficiencies are and to use digital technologies to transform how we teach and how we heal. It doesn't mean going all online, but it means thinking in a hybrid way, especially when we talk about how we learn, slide number 7, please, of a classroom that is both physical and virtual. Students have got this figured out. They can learn on their phones easily, but we have to ensure that our systems, that our education systems, including as employers in corporate learning, provide for both in-person and online learning as this revolution takes place. And this is an enormous export opportunity for Canada. We published a paper this fall based on a concept I talked about at the University of Saskatchewan before COVID, about building a global platform in this country that provide that can sell our education services, our classes, to the world of learners, wherever they are, whenever they want it. Saskatchewan can help us on that front, open up its education system to the world. Which takes me to our last point of how we trade. We're gonna live in a more protectionist world in the coming years, regardless of what's happened in the US election. There's gonna be more local procurement, more strategic procurement by governments. We all have to take advantage of that, but your members have to be on their game for that opportunity. I'll get to that in the wrap up. But we have to see the new world of trade as being about intangibles. It's not just about ag products from Saskatchewan, as critical as they are, or manufactured goods from Ontario. It is about the knowledge-based exports of health knowledge, of education knowledge, of agriculture knowledge, that we can be selling as a service to the world at a much higher value than we've seen. So an opportunity for us as well as a challenge. Let me wrap up with a few quick observations of what this means. As I think through these trends, I hope you can see how we're living now in a distributed economy. The 20th century was all about centralized economies, office towers, universities, shopping malls, factories. All of that has been distributed, scattered, and people are taking advantage of the advantages of that. Businesses that can seize on a distributed economy, that can find the point of transaction, not where they are, not in a centralized place, but at the point of economic activity in a distributed model, are going to have an advantage. Businesses that can think of hybrid models, hard from an efficiency point of view, but again, puts you ahead of your competitors, are going to be ahead. Businesses that appreciate how habits become hardwired after about 6 months and realize that consumers, our employees, our shoppers are not going back. They want these different models. And those are our habits are now hardwired in us. Businesses that understand that are going to be ahead. Businesses that understand that we live in a world of perpetual data, that you shouldn't be waiting for a spreadsheet to arrive, that you have to know the data is always flowing and you should always be learning from it, are going to be at an advantage. And let's see and think about the opportunities out there. There is wealth out there that we can take advantage of. We're seeing this in the growth of real estate wealth and the growth of stock market wealth. How do businesses leverage that wealth and the enormous pools of capital out there that want to invest in productive assets? How do you take advantage of the new loyalty game that's taking place on those platforms? Something like 40% of US consumers have tried something new in this, have purchased something new in this crisis from an online channel. Loyalty is up for grabs. That means your loyal relationships are up for grabs and others are taking advantage of that. But it also means you have an opportunity to win the loyalty of customers you never perhaps knew before. That requires a different form of engagement. All of us have built physical business models. We know what engagement is like in a store or in a bank branch. how do we continue to think about engagement in a digital economy? And how do we use that to reach new consumers, consumers beyond our geography? Which takes me to my last slide about what we need to do, and what you can and your customers, your business partners can think about coming out of this crisis. Well, number one is to rethink your addressable market. If you think of a platform economy, the addressable market for you is no longer Saskatchewan. For us, it's no longer Canada. You have the opportunity to reach every consumer on the face of the earth. So how do you make your addressable market planet Earth? Secondly, how do you make yourself more relevant to government as we move into a historic moment of government spending, whether you think that's a good or bad thing? There are hundreds of billions of dollars of government spending at the federal and provincial levels up for grabs over the next couple of years. And how are your members and how are you as a business positioned to take advantage of that flow to help governments achieve their goals, but also to make your business more productive and more competitive? How do you see, number three, everything that you do as exportable, especially in the services economy? How do you think of the knowledge that the members of the Saskatchewan Chamber create every day? How do you think of that as an exportable product to the world? Well, one way is number four, to see yourself as a digital platform or as part of a digital platform. The economy of the 2020s is going to be a platform economy. The game is going to be won on those platforms. So how are you positioned either to build or be part of a new platform or to compete on those global platforms? Well, one of the ways that we all need to do that is the last point I'll leave you with is reskilling. We also have a moment now as we're reflecting and struggling through this crisis to think about the skills that we all need to accelerate in a very different economy. I hope we all recognize that in ourselves, that the skills we had a year ago are probably not the skills we're going to need 1 year from now. So how does business work with the educators of this country in a real-time way to create the skills that we all need and that small business really can take advantage of to power the sort of economic transformation that we discuss in the Small Business Big Pivot report? We need to do that in that great Canadian way by working together. Big business, small business, public sector, private sector, young, old. We've done that through this crisis to get through this crisis. We've got to do that in the recovery to make sure that it is a prosperous recovery for all. So thank you for, again, sharing this the screen with me. And I look forward to your questions and the conversation that we're about to have. If you're interested in more, please follow us at rbc.com/thoughtleadership. You can follow me on social media. Or you can pick up our reports, the 8 Trends Report or the Small Business Big Pivot Report at rbc.com. And if you're a podcast listener, please listen to the Disruptors podcast through Apple, Google, or Spotify. We've got a new episode out today on 5G and how that is going to help power a lot of what we've been discussing. So again, thank you and look forward to the comments and questions.
John, that was as we thought it would be, excellent. Now, the only notice, of course, I'll reference first is that we're going to be here now till 4 o'clock. You've given us so much to talk about, so that's all right. Now, let me go to Alisha from Road Coffee. I introduced her a minute ago, but Alisha, give us a sense of what you've done in Road Coffee to react perhaps to some of the trends that John has referenced or what you've done uniquely. Please, Alisha, go ahead.
For sure. Thank you, Stephen. Thanks for having me share today. John, I loved your insights. I think they're really helpful and right on track with where we're going, at least a good idea. I also felt like it related to what we've been doing. So I this is good. This is exciting. We've been going after data hard as a coffee company. We actually launched our new website, March 13th, the day before Saskatchewan went into official crisis mode, I guess we could say. And it was perfect timing. The reason we were rebuilding our website is it wasn't producing the sales. It wasn't data-driven, and it wasn't focused on e-commerce the way we needed it to. And so we knew that our data was showing us we needed to change our online approach. And I'm glad we did, because that first week when things hit in March, 95% of our business went on pause. A lot of our business at the time was corporate clients. We were growing rapidly in the corporate scene. And it was scary. It was a little nerve-wracking. I remember talking to our team and having to make some hard decisions at the time. And we immediately went to work on our digital strategy and just pivoted hard into it. And part of that digital strategy was trying different things. And so the biggest thing for us was understanding who our new target market is. We had to evaluate, has it shifted? Coffee obviously isn't going anywhere, right? People are still drinking coffee. They might not be drinking coffee in their offices or in cafes and restaurants. They're drinking it at home. So we started focusing on getting lots of content out there and seeing what people might relate to. We did see an awesome push with the support local, which was great, but we didn't want to bank on that forever. And so we started to try and meet our audiences where they were at. And that came down to what we call growth hacking. It's a strategy that a lot of these big tech companies use. And we just took that and started applying that strategy to our company. It's basically you test really small things, and then you see what works. You look at the data and you iterate. So since then we've launched a loyalty program through our online store. We've launched a YouTube channel. We've launched a TikTok. We've launched push notifications to computers. We are putting out a ridiculous amount of content. We also launched a video interview series where we're interviewing other entrepreneurs and other thought leaders shaking up their industry. And these are all ways to lead people back to our online store. We also recently, so I like what you said also, John, about the hybrid model, because coffee, people still want to buy coffee on location. And so we were doing, you know, curbside pickup and deliveries within Saskatoon. But we also recently launched in Sobeys, and it was a partnership that we put on hold last year because we didn't feel at the time it was the right direction we wanted to go. We were going in a different direction, and we ended up revisiting that a few months ago, and now we're in Sobeys, and we're I'm really grateful for what we're seeing there. And now we're trying to market to both, you know, that on location, but also online. I feel like I could talk a lot, but I'll kind of leave it at that for now, and I'm sure the discussion will continue.
Well, thank you. You've given us lots to think about too, and Sobeys, that's a pretty cool deal. Good for you. We'll come back to that. Let me now go to Shawn Moen from 9 Mile Legacy Brewers. Shawn, tell us your story.
Sure. And just checking, Steve, if everyone can hear me okay.
Yes, connection? You sound great.
Okay. There's a bit of poetry in kind of how this webinar is happening today. We, as many of you know, we've had a significant blizzard in Saskatoon. I was set up to be doing this from my office at the brewery. So let's talk about work from home. We've got a little two-year-old. An effect of the blizzard is that our childcare isn't functioning today. I'm on my home Wi-Fi, which has a bit of instability. And I am parked in one of our bedrooms because I'm not quite set up to work from home because I haven't had to do it. You know, so I think about it. I was kind of smiling, John, through your presentation and talking about work from home, because I think there's a lot of really good things about it. But, you know, this today, just to me, just underlines the serious inequities that can result if we're not thinking about all of the related aspects of people being remote and having their ordinary reliances disrupted. You know, whether it's secure internet, whether it's supports for childcare, and just having to reimagine things. So bear with me. I hope my signal holds. My story is similar to Alisha in a sense, but I think she's done a lot of stuff a lot better than we have. And so I'm taking a lot of guidance from her comments. Middle of March, we had two marketing initiatives planned for 2020, big marketing initiatives. One was a significant player in the Junos in Saskatoon. We had probably about 8 different activation points as the Junos approached. And we also had done a custom beer with the Saskatoon Blades, which was a really big thing for a little brewery like us. We had cracked into the stadium and we were going to be serving our Blade City beer. I remember fondly, well, maybe not that fondly, maybe there's a bit of nostalgia, but in hindsight, but watching basketball, and I think it was March 11th when Rudy Gobert is diagnosed with COVID, mm-hmm. and all of the leagues start shutting down and all of the major events start shutting down. And at the same time, we're gearing up to hold the Junos. And we all know what happened there. The Junos decided rightly to cancel, and we entered into a lockdown period. Overnight for us, as similar to Road Coffee, we had about 85 to 90% of our sales channels disrupted. We were, as a small brewery, it just kind of caught us at an interesting time. We were pretty reliant on taproom sales and on on-premise draft accounts, so kegs, right? People going out for pints. And people coming into the tap room to fill their growlers and to sit down and have a taster flight and enjoy what we do well, which is bringing community together. All of that disappears middle of March. And so we're left with, the year prior we had invested in a semi-automated bottler. We had been hand filling bottles one by one with a bottle filling gun before that and had invested in a bottler. We had secured the bulk of pieces to our expansion project, which would see a production facility and a canning line surface a couple blocks away. But we were essentially, when the dust settled, we had about 10% of our sales channels left. And so we had to lean heavily into sales of our bottle product. We had to find where our consumers were. And so we made the decision. We had been planning to invest heavily into online commerce for several years. But because of the size of our brewery, it just wasn't urgent. We were selling all of the beer that we were making leading up into it. And so what we ended up doing is we contacted Zoo Communications in Saskatoon. They're a great digital firm, design thinking firm, to plan out our online store. It was really the acceleration of a long-term strategy of designing the 9 Mile Legacy digital ecosystem, which would have a number of different interaction points and really find our consumers and partners and friends in a spot where we could provide them what they needed. Things that we've been concerned about, which I imagine we'll get into, is use and abuse of data. You know, I don't think we talk about that enough and how the other shoe is going to drop, I think, for a lot of people in a few years in terms of how big tech is misusing our data in a lot of ways. What it means to authentically connect with people online and try to recreate what I think is a very welcoming and safe tap room, but how to imagine that online. You know, there were easier options, I think, at the start of March. You could go off the shelf with a Shopify solution or a Square solution or something like that. But really, we wanted to start building the foundations to the digital experience that 9 Mile Legacy will be able to offer beyond the liquid in a glass. And so for us, it made sense to invest heavily into that sort of approach right from the start. We saw home deliveries pop right up in response. April and May were very busy as the economy reopened and people went back out for drinks. We saw that decline again. And so we're now having to rethink how we make that value proposition and how to adapt to a new normal, particularly in a blizzard. Because the digital logistics are only one piece of it, right? We've also got physical logistics, you know, how people get in and make beer together, how we drive our beer to our consumers. And for small businesses, I think the digital piece is only one small part of it. It results in hitting a number of dominoes that relate to the physical aspects of getting your product to people when you deal with something that is physical. I think it's always a work in progress for us, and it has been for the last 5 years. I made the crack kind of early on when we were planning a number of these strategies. I found it funny. I don't know that our accountant found it funny, but we've been flirting with bankruptcy for the last 5 years as a small business anyway. So what's a little pandemic, you know, to try to figure out how to maneuver your way through all of this? And I'm only kind of overstating that. But I think it's going to be a constant work in progress and trying to figure out how we continue to do what we do well and how that provides value to people, and how to use digital as a tool, an extremely necessary tool and an ever more growing necessary tool to continue to do what we do. So that's a little bit about us. Long story short, the pandemic hit, wiped out most of our sales. We had to develop a digital presence, and we're working at continuing to build us. And we had the good fortune of having it hit us when we had an expansion project underway to add more package products.
That's quite a story. The most telling question, of course, as we're getting through the chat line, is how much do you want for that bottle filling gun that you obviously aren't using anymore? It would save an awful lot of time. And Adam, our friend from J&E, has sent that in. I'm just kidding, Adam.
Museum piece, Steve. You know, we've kept our original brewery too. I think they're going to be all very, you know, in a very happy way displayed for us to remember where we came from and for other people too. So not for sale.
Not for sale. All right. Well, that's probably more than a guy would want to drink at once anyway. So between the three of you, you've given us lots of things to consider here. I'm going to turn it out. Now it's the panel time. So John and Alisha and you, Shawn, I've got some questions for you. Now, if I was an old guy, just happened to be typecasting myself, and I said, you know, I have got to a point in my business where now you're telling me I need to go digital. And how do I do all those things that you've talked about, data analytics and new website and this sort of thing? How do I do that when I'm working at the till in my hardware store or at the counter in my kitchen? That's a real challenge, and not just for old people. It's for all ages because people are working in their business, not just on. How do they do that? Alisha, let me start with you, then John, then Shawn. Give me a couple of minutes on what you think they should do.
I think figuring out what your smallest win is first is what I would do if I was selling hardware stuff, or for us was just getting an online site there. If you don't have a website, even if it's not super complex or high tech, simple works. There's keep it simple, right? There's a reason that's a saying. I think starting just with the basics of technical foundations is a start. And then what I'm a big fan of, and I talk to our team a lot about is building community online, which is something we can all do. If you know how to text, then you can message on different platforms like LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram. Building your online community is going to be very essential to that transition.
Okay, that's good advice. John, what would you tell that person who I just referenced a minute ago?
I just love everything that Shawn and Alisha are saying. That's brilliant. I've been scribbling notes here. I want to follow up with them to learn more because they are so on their game here. That point from Alisha about community is really essential. You need to build a big pool, a big community. Look at a case study in the Small Business Big Pivot report of an ice cream store in Winnipeg, which also, like Alisha, had to shut down. And they flipped the model on their head and sold subscriptions through Facebook to their community. So you pay X dollars a month and be able to tap on your phone and get ice cream delivered when you want it, where you want it. That may be the future, or may just be a bridge to the future in that hybrid environment. If I can add anything, it's on the skilling front, because I think that's at the heart of the question. I hope the chamber can help build a bridge with education institutions, colleges and universities, to help use work-integrated learning, internships, apprenticeships, co-op placements, to bring in that brain power and a new generation to help you. So if you're a hardware store trying to develop a data strategy, yeah, that's probably something you may not have time for, may not have inclination for, but I'll bet you there's a class at USASC or at SAS Polytech that could help answer that problem for you. I spent time with a small business operator in Moncton, New Brunswick, who was kind of skeptical about this. He was a heavy manufacturing machine products maker. And he teamed up with the University of New Brunswick to get students to come in and help him figure out these problems. Business is doing great. So use the new generation, use the strength of our schools, and I hope that Chamber can probably already is, but can be a facilitator.
Shawn, thanks, John. Shawn, what are your thoughts on that? How do you get it
done? Yeah, it's challenging for a lot of people, and I think that there are really good tools out there from a reskilling perspective. We've made use of our provincial government's job grant program and put one of our staff members through design thinking training, and he'll have oversight over our website and our online tap room, and that was purposeful. I think of this really as largely having to rapidly figure out how to redeploy your capital, and so that might be assets that you have in the business, like hard assets, or it might be people, and trying to figure out what people are good at and how to rapidly get them onto spots where it's actually going to make a difference, and recognize which areas you're fragile on. That can be really hard for a small mom and pop shop. I guess what I would encourage is to look at those sorts of programs that allow you to level up. Look at other relief programs as a way to level up. I think if you're accessing relief programs with the purpose of maintaining normal as we've planned and understood it, you're in real, real trouble. If you're looking at those programs as a way to effectively expand through this and change the nature of what you're doing, that's where I think from a substantive perspective, the mindset needs to go. I've been reading a lot lately and kind of popular coinage, I don't think it's in all circles, is to talk about this as the great lockdown. And I really don't like that description. I've more thought about it as the great accelerator or the great disruption. The great lockdown to me infers that this is a temporary situation that was imposed by public health orders or by government, and it isn't, in my view. This is a psychological shift as much as it is a public health shift. And so understanding that consumers are and habits are forever changed, I think allows you to then take a look at problems, like specific problems, like how do I do digital and how do I maneuver digital if I'm at the till at a hardware store, by saying, okay, I need to actually transform. And this is, I now have these advantages. These advantages have been made available to me by government and by industry organizations and consumers, frankly, because they're really keen to help you, right? And I can use those then to get to the next step and to really think about my unique value proposition, you know, core business stuff. If you're not thinking about that stuff anyway, you are going to be in trouble with business. But really understanding the value that you bring to people and then how to level that up to get to them to where they are. I think if you have that substantive mindset, then the skills acquisition and execution becomes a little bit easier. So I look at it as a bit more of a substantive issue.
I think you're right. And it's not, I think you're right about the terminology as well. This is not the lockdown. Anybody that looks at it that way expects the world to come back to normal. There is no normal. We call it the new abnormal. And that's the reality. A couple of points I want to reiterate. One of them is the idea of walking forward on it. You don't have to turn into a Alisha kind of capacity overnight, but these small operators, and we have them across the province, city and rural, they've all got a kid who spends too much time on his phone, and instead of that being a problem, make it an opportunity. Figure out how to use that kid's skill to get you online. I think there's great merit in that. There's professional companies. We have a partnership with Sask Poly on training, to John's point about Chamber's role in this with Southeast College. And we have members like our chair, as a matter of fact, her company teaches entrepreneurship. So there's lots of educational opportunities there. So don't think that somebody has to eat the entire elephant. What they have to do is start to walk forward and ask their members, building that community, as you say. Let me go back to something I saw in the paper, and this, Shawn, you referenced a bit of this, that as an entrepreneur, you're continually walking that fine line between being a billionaire and going broke. Whether you're large or small, it doesn't really matter. But, John, in the report, you talked about companies that we could have a situation where more companies would not survive the recovery because they didn't embrace the realities of this new economy, then we lost at the beginning because they had to go into the lockdown, if you will, or the shutdown. Do you think Canada is effectively prepared for that reality? And I'll tell you what, I've got it highlighted on my report that I read. I've told five or six people about it because that's one of those things I hadn't thought about. that we can lose a lot more because of the transition to the new economy, the digital economy, than we lost because of sales. Are we prepared as Canadians, as a Canadian business community, sufficiently, John?
No, and our governments are not adequately prepared. One of the things we've been stressing to governments, I mean, look, a lot of heroic work was done in the spring, but in hindsight, we may have over-indexed a little bit too much to households and not enough to business. And as a result, one of the interesting data points that we determined this summer was there was probably $30 billion more put into household accounts, largely through CERB, but through other relief programs, than was lost through payroll suspensions. Meaning in aggregate, Canadians had $30 billion more towards the end of the summer than they might otherwise have had, which is why there was all that consumption. Why there was so much spending on home renovations, on recreation. We're seeing it in our savings accounts, checking and savings accounts. Balances are very high. The national savings rate is way up. That's gotten us through. We need to think about how to shift a lot of that assistance, probably less in aggregate, but proportionally, to small business, not just as relief, although some of that may be needed through the winter, depending on how deep of a lockdown different provinces need to go into, but to ensure that that money is going towards repositioning and supporting entrepreneurs and operators with all the questions and challenges that are coming up. How do we help that hardware store owner? And how do we use some of government assistance to help that hardware store owner or help Alisha and Shawn with their strategies, developing the capacities and capabilities to take on the 2020s. If we don't, we're going to be at risk because consumer habits are changing. Consumers are not going to rush back to an old way. One last point I'd leave you with is that in Q3, the United States saw a record number of businesses being created, largely small businesses. So in that great American way, people lose their job, they lose their businesses. What do? They go and start a new one. Now, some of that was registering so you can get payments and the like, but there is some creative destruction going on in the US that we need to see and accelerate here. And I don't mean creative destruction in a negative way. I mean, businesses either shutting down and starting anew or taking on new opportunities in this digital platform economy. But that's going to take all of us really pushing harder than we have been.
Yeah, interesting. You know, I think it refers to the report as well, but this is, on some estimates, this would be the worst time in the world to start a business. I would argue, and I think your paper does too, and I think Shawn and Alisha would argue, this is absolutely the best time to start a business, because you know more than you did 6 months ago or 12 months ago. Speak to that, Shawn, if you will, because people walk in, and I'm sure every day, I used to be in the bar business, and on Saturday nights, everybody wanted to own a bar. Mondays, not so much. But in the brewery business, everybody wants to own a brewery, but you get all kinds of wannabe entrepreneurs, and God bless them, coming in. But what advice would you give to somebody now that you wouldn't have gave them 7 months ago in terms of starting up any business? Shawn, and then I'll go to Alisha, please.
I don't know that my advice would change all that much. I think that if you're starting a business, you need to do your homework in a very serious way. I mean, we took about a year before we, between when we quit our professional careers and started 9 Mile Legacy, to essentially work in other breweries and do, we affectionately call it our homemade MBA. So it was learning soup to nuts in all of these breweries and really getting serious about it and designing a good business plan. I don't think that advice really changes. I think there's lots of opportunity. I think you have to be realistic in terms of where the risk is these days. And maybe that's just more apparent right now. I think the one thing that John's report does very well is highlight the uneven distribution of risk, or at least risk tolerance amongst industries. And, you know, we've got 2 feet essentially as a business. One is in ag value, which is, I mean, we had a banner year in Saskatchewan, and we you know, it's with pride as a farm boy that we're able to turn Saskatchewan barley into something that has secondary and tertiary value. So ag value is a bit more resilient. And on the other hand, we're selling to bars and restaurants, and man, oh man, is it fragile. And I think we're going to see just a real significant shakeup, because a lot of those experiences aren't intuitively portable. And so if you're looking to start a business, I think you'd be really wise to, again, do your homework, make sure you've got good fundamentals, but make sure you're doing something that, you know, is portable, and you're designing a business model in a way that you can get to people. You know, if we were starting 9 Mile today, we certainly wouldn't be basing, you know, 40, 50% of our revenue on a tap room, you know, just knowing the current state of affairs. Now that will likely change. But the cans that are coming out of our new facility is going to be what saves and grows our business. And I think that was always going to be the case anyway. So just really being tuned in to the fragility, and I suppose the anti-fragility of the respective sales channels in your business, and do your homework.
Yeah, interesting. So fundamentally, it hasn't changed. The one that people didn't do to the extent that they want to now, I would argue, is the digital presence. Alisha, what advice would you give now that you made that may be different, perhaps, Shawn, it wouldn't be different, to an entrepreneur who walks up and buys a coffee and says, hey?
Yeah, for sure. It's similar to Shawn. I think the foundations of business are still there and they still exist. It's just the how they're executed. There's a really good leadership book called What Got You Here Won't Get You There. And I think that this is a perfect time. Even for me, I thought that book would apply to me later in life, but here we are, and what got our company to where it is isn't going to take it to that next stage. And so it's a really great time for entrepreneurs, because if you're starting from scratch, the world is your oyster right now. And if you do your research and homework, you're going to see very quickly there's a lot of gaps in the market, and there's a lot of industries that need people to rise up and take those risks. So I'm excited to see what's going to come out. And I would, you know, I love my company. I'm stoked on what we're doing, but I think it would be a really fun challenge to also start fresh right now.
Interesting. John, let me go back to you. Your colleagues in RBC, you get to think about things. They have to actually work with the different clients, but what you just heard, is that, would you share or mirror that advice to the person walking into an RBC in Rosetown, Saskatchewan today, saying, I'd like to open a business, should I?
Yeah, if you've got a clear plan, it's not an easy time to open a business, but I agree, it may be the best time or among the best times that you could. If you look at the last, all the great businesses of the last decade, many of them started in the global financial crisis, because that's when things are really being shaken up. So if you have a clear business plan, if you have thought through how you can take advantage of disruption rather than be either a passive observer or a victim of it, then we'd like to have that conversation.
I like the term disruptor, the great disruption, and obviously tags back to the report as well and the podcast. Good plug for the podcast there, Shawn, by using that term earlier. But I think you're right. There is things that people are doing and buying and spending money on now that they didn't before. Identify those and away we go. As Alisha said, people are still drinking coffee, just not necessarily drinking it in their offices like they used to. Interesting. On the chat, there's lots of conversations about Saskatchewan educational assets, and I wanted to reference that to the group. There are 25 private colleges, there's the regional colleges, obviously universities, and high schools. For some of the social media work, I'll give you a quick example, a little plug for one of our programs. It's called 10, and what it does, it's going out to local communities across the province, identifying where there's skill gaps or opportunities, gig workers is a prime one for the social media and the digitization. It might be somebody who's really good at it, but doesn't do it professionally, but could on a commercial basis. So there's lots of opportunities there. So if you're interested, have a look at our website, saschamber.com/10, and you'll see the information as it becomes available. John, I want to take us back to your trends. how we workshop, watch, and so on. The travel is, you know, without depressing the conversation, it's a challenged sector globally.
Mm-hmm.
Let me take you out 2023, and you're standing around the water cooler in RBC's World Domination headquarters, and they're talking about travel. What do you expect to hear people are doing? Conventions, leisure, whatever it might be. What's 2023's travel world going to look like?
What a great, great question. If I can just echo first your point on education, I think there's an enormous opportunity for education providers to change their addressable market. I was struck, I spent a lot of time speaking to colleges and universities, and before the pandemic, everyone was saying, this online education thing, it's MOOCs were a failure, this is not going anywhere. And guess what? When you're forced to figure something out, you figure it out. And there will be a hybrid model for education, but the ones that can create digital learning, and it's not just about putting a classroom on YouTube, it's about creating personalized education, are going to find an enormous market for what they do. So I would suggest there's a good little moment here for the educators who are online. Travel in some ways is going to be more challenged because those kind of mass-based travel conventions, hard to see those coming back anytime soon. Business travel is going to be challenged. We see that in our own enterprise. People are not allowed to travel for business. I think getting a trip approved is going to be pretty hard, even when travel, a business trip approved, that is going to be pretty hard when we get back. But we will need opportunities to get together in person. So it's not that travel will disappear. It's not that business travel will disappear. But it will not be at the scale that it was pre-pandemic. So centers that rely on conventions, for instance, are going to have to rethink a bit of their model. But again, they if they invest in the right technologies, they can reach far more people than they did ever in person. A couple of examples that we cite in our report. One is Travis Scott, the country singer, who is now putting his concerts in the middle of Fortnite video games. And he, for one concert this summer, got 14 million viewers. He doesn't need to do arena tours anymore. AOC, the Democrat politician from New York, is now doing her rallies on Twitch. She had one recently that had, that's the Amazon platform, had 400,000 live viewers. She doesn't need to do a rally anymore. So those are indications of where things are going. And those who have relied on that centralized model, the convention center being part of that, are going to need to think, how do they remodel the convention center, literally, to connect with people in different ways, and then create virtual conventions to be bringing people in at 10x the number that you had before.
Yeah, I think you're right. And that's the rethinking of it. Of course, you didn't note it, but you were going to go, if you're watching an online concert, folks, you'd want to have 9 Mile Legacy beer or a nice road coffee in your home. But I think you're right. You start to look at the magnitude of some of those concerts, some of those shows, it's a big deal. And I think it's changed forever. We may not have had the opportunity to have John join us in Saskatchewan today had it not been for the virtual. And Shawn has to go back shoveling snow in a half an hour, so he couldn't have driven down to join us without the virtual. I think you're absolutely right. And morphing to that quickly is critical. Yeah, it's interesting. I want to go back to governments for a second. Shawn, you talked about government support in terms of the training programs, which anybody that's listening that haven't looked at the Canada Job Grant information, you're missing a huge opportunity to enhance your skills. Do that. It's your money that the government's reallocating. John, you talked about the programs that need to be, in some cases, maintained but refined. The report talks about that as well. And government focus in terms of strategy is critical. As chambers, both we as the provincial chamber, of course, the Canadian chamber, your friend John in the Ontario chamber, Rocco Rossi, we all work with governments and we take the opinion of our members to government to make sure it's there. Small plug for chambers, but I think it's critical. But John, let me go to you on this one. If the Prime Minister is your next meeting and he says, okay, what are we going to do next? We've done lots. We've spent $350 billion, whatever the number is today. What do we need to do next? And it's a quick call. What are you going to tell him in terms of government support? And then Shawn and Alisha, what do you tell the Premier?
I would say digital transformation for SMEs. And that includes the technology and tools to do all the things that we're talking about and the skills and access to the skills to thrive in a platform economy. And then thirdly, and some of this can be working with chambers, creating Canadian platforms for Canadian producers and consumers to come together. We were at RBC part of the Canada, we helped with the Ontario Chamber launch the Canada United program this summer, which was an enormous success. How do we build on that for the future so that there is a permanent Canadian platform where if you want to buy Canadian or sell to Canadians, that's where you can go.
Alisha, what would you tell the Premier to do if he said, I've got 5 minutes, tell me what to do with our resources or programs or whatever?
I like the idea of a Canadian platform. I think it would be an easier way to figure out how to support Canadian companies. And honestly, digital literacy, it's a big thing. Even with like younger staff, it takes a while to learn and understand things. And I think if we can develop programs that shorten that gap, that could be really helpful.
Interesting. All right, thank you. To you, Shawn, what would you tell the Premier?
Heck of a question. You know, I think that the need for good strategic vision is really essential. And I think taking a look at our overall economy and understanding where the opportunities are from a macro perspective and from a provincial perspective is really important. You know me, Steve, I'm bullish on agriculture and being in the ag value industry, I think there's always lots of ways that we can level up what we do in the province. And, you know, as a young boy, I never understood why we were shipping Durham wheat out and not making noodles. And now I get to make beer, which is great. A lot more fun than noodles, frankly. But, you know, I think that, yeah, making sure that we're applying our resources in a really strategic way and long-term way. I think the cold reality, and this is something that I didn't have gray hair before the pandemic, right? I had a little bit, but it was, you know, thinking about the attrition we're likely to have in our community, in our small business community. I think that, you know, we are pretty sensitive to it, supplying a number of really good small business food and beverage companies, but whether it's bars, restaurants, retail stores, and the like, the good ones are going to make it out. I'm not worried about our partners that are thinking creatively and strategically and moving forward. There's going to be a lot that don't necessarily. And I think that, you know, I there's only so much we can do from a financial support perspective if people aren't evolving rapidly. And so, you know, I'm not totally shy of further government support. And I think there's still latitude for that, but it has to be purposeful. It can't just be to pay current expenses. We need to be able to power through this, I think. And so it starts from a macro perspective. Let's be very strategic and develop good vision, I think.
I think you're right. It's not just in maintaining, it's building. As the Prime Minister announced yesterday, a plan to go much more aggressively in terms of internet access around the country, which gives everybody the infrastructure to do those things, business, individuals, educators, students. That's obviously a priority of our chamber and has been for a long time, so we applaud his efforts. It is interesting. Today, we have been advocating for financial literacy with groups like RBC, and today or in the next day or so, you're going to see information on a program out of the Saskatoon Industry Education Council. It's called Money Sense. So we've worked for a long time to get students primarily financially literate. Now, to Alicia's point, we have to work faster to get them digitally literate so that when they get older and into business, working or as a customer, digital literacy is going to be critical. So is financial, but certainly digital literacy is critical. Interesting. Now, folks, we're at 10 minutes to the hour when we're going to release you out to back into the world. I'm watching the chats, as I promised that if there was questions there, we would try and bring them forward. We've tried to bring in the education pieces, lots of conversation there. There's an idea that somebody talked about where you get on a flight in, I'll call it Regina, you fly over top of Calgary while you're having dinner and drinks on the airplane, and then you land back in Regina. You're in the same bubble. It's an interesting idea. They talked Australia, but that's a longer flight. And anybody who's interested in doing that for airplane food, you go ahead. As long as they got the right coffee, the right beer, I guess it would be okay. So there's lots of ideas there that are being shared, and I appreciate that. Let me go to you, John, on the trends and say, okay, what's next for RBC? You've done lots of different reports. Give us a bit of a sneak preview here. The trends, we will take them, and it's up to us now that you've shared the knowledge to try and walk them and get them more exposed to people and so on. But what's next for RBC? What's the next mountain of thought leadership you're about to climb?
No, thanks for that question and for your interest in the work we're doing on thought leadership. There's a few significant pieces we're looking or developing for 2021. One is a really good piece of research on Indigenous youth and how we can help them take advantage of these trends. Biggest, fastest growing demographic in the country, critical as everyone in Saskatchewan knows, to our collective prosperity and well-being as a nation in the 2020s. And we think this tech revolution that's underway can be challenging, even threatening to Indigenous youth, but also a terrific opportunity to kind of leap ahead into a very different future. Similarly, we need to understand the energy transition that is underway and how to position Canada better as a lower emissions, higher efficiency producer of oil and gas and other forms of energy for the world's consumption. We think this is a big opportunity if we go about it a bit differently in the country. Great technology at play in Alberta and Saskatchewan that we need to double down on. And then thirdly is understanding better where the growth is going to come from in the years ahead. We're $1 trillion in the hole, probably, because of this crisis as a country. We gotta figure out a new game plan. If we're going to create more than $1 trillion, we're gonna need a couple of $1 trillion of new wealth over the 2020s to pay down that debt. And we're gonna have to do it in this digital economy. So all we've been talking about today is fascinating. I've been taking copious notes, but it's gotta speak to that national mission, but also national emergency, if we don't get it right, that we have to create trillions of dollars of wealth in the years ahead to pay off the debts that we've taken on because of COVID. We can do it, but we've got to have a plan to do it and understand that it's going to be a more competitive, more digitally enabled economy in the years ahead. And we've got to help our entrepreneurs accelerate and get behind them.
Yeah, very good. I appreciate those. We're working on a paper here. We'll have a process we'll have out this fall, the low carbon papers, we call it. It's about the low carbon economy, because while we still fully embrace our conventional oil and gas, we're also very cognizant there's money to be spent, opportunities there in the lower carbon world, and we're trying to understand what that looks like. So to our members, you'll see that. You also referenced Aboriginal youth in Saskatchewan. I think we have the largest percentage of Aboriginal youth. It's a huge, huge advantage for Saskatchewan if we do it properly. And we're working with the Indigenous communities. We have a director of Indigenous engagement who's, I think, online right now, probably with his young daughter on his knee. And we're doing some real good work there, training, as well as we have an Indigenous supplier directory. So anybody that's interested in those things, we have it available for you. So I applaud that. And I look forward, John, to the continued efforts of of RBC in terms of leading the much of the thought leadership across the country. I think what you've done to date has been great. Now, we're 6 minutes in. Shawn, I'm going to almost finish with you, but I'm going to give you a couple of minutes. As we close off this session today, we've appreciated the learnings that you've shared with us, but give me a couple of minutes. What advice do you want most that people take away from this session? Then I'll go to Alisha. I'll give the 2 minutes to John as well, and then I'll wind everybody up.
I guess I keep banging the same drum, Steve. And today, John had a really interesting observation from a macro national perspective. We're incurring a whole bunch more debt, and how do we grow so that we can ultimately pay it back? And that is so relevant to the street as well, where if you're a business that has had to struggle through this and figure out how to get to the next step, you've taken on debt, right? We have. And I think about that quite a bit as to how we're going to pay it back. We need to grow, and we need to seize opportunity to do so. Otherwise, we're just kicking the can down the road. So, you know, I think that really underlining that people need to be growth, have a growth mindset, and that can be challenging if you've been 25 years in the game, let's say, and things were working well. But the reality is we've all kind of entered back into startup mode, and may as well embrace that and have fun with it as opposed to be concerned about that.
Great. Good point. Alisha, what's the two-minute takeaway from you?
Like that. I think I would just want to encourage business owners and entrepreneurs to not be timid or afraid of these changes, because as big as that chasm might be to the digital world, you know, soon we'll just be like, Alexa, order me some more coffee. And to fight for that kind of space and market share might be scary or challenging for a lot of business owners and entrepreneurs, but it's also, I think we're at a really interesting time, especially in Saskatchewan, where, you know, we just don't have numbers in Saskatchewan. We don't have as many people. And so this is a great opportunity for us to start exporting outside of Saskatchewan and outside of Canada. And I think if we can put in the hard work and figure out strategies to connect those dots, we could do really well in the future as a province.
Excellent. And you'll let us know when we can say to Alexa, send me more road coffee. Thank you. John, 2 minutes takeaway. What would you tell this, what do you want this group to know?
That there is more opportunity than threat out there, and that opportunity will come very quickly. And when I talk to business leaders about lessons from past crises, many say their biggest regret is not taking advantage of the pivot to growth when it comes, because it comes quicker and faster. Economic growth tends to be faster coming out of a crisis. So be prepared for when that opportunity comes, and know that it will be on a different platform, literally, that consumer expectations have shifted, as have employee expectations during this crisis. And if you are understanding and meeting those expectations, secondly, if you're using data to understand your relevance to your consumers and getting in front of their needs, as Alisha and Shawn have been discussing, then you are going to be well positioned to be there for that rapid growth. But be sure that growth can come very, very quickly. So be confident and be ready for it.
Yeah, excellent advice. You know, a couple of things I'll reference. One of them is, Alisha referenced earlier about a book that she read, and there's lots of material out there. And I'll put a plug in again for everybody that's listening. You've got a day tomorrow with a little bit of free time, perhaps. You've got evenings. Instead of just watching Netflix, trust me, the Sons of Anarchy, they're going to be okay without you, folks. There's 79 seasons or something, so you've got some time. But take the opportunity to not only read what others have done, but I would argue go and talk to those that are there. To Alicia's point, not only for your customers, but for your intellectual advantage, build a community. Find out those companies that are online that are doing good things and go and have a chat with them, in person or digitally, whatever works best. I want to say thanks to the folks at RBC and you, especially John, for all of your information today, and of course the information that you've shared online with us over the years. We'll see John again, I hope, in the next while. I want to say thanks to Shawn and Alisha. You're great ambassadors for Saskatchewan. You've done exactly what everybody wants to have said they have done. And because of your sharing today, I hope it's going to be what they said they did do. And they'll go back to this date and remember it and be better companies, better individuals because of it. I also want to say thanks to our team here at the Chamber. I switched offices just before we came because I ran out of beer in that one, and I wanted to come where the beer was. And you know, they're obviously it's a delivery problem, right? I'm kidding. I also want to say to our board of directors and all of our members, thanks for your continued participation in things like this. It's important that we as chambers continue with thought leadership. Today online, we've got lots of our local chamber colleagues, and I want to reference their participation as well. Now, one final thing is this. Tomorrow is Remembrance Day, and I want each of you to take a moment. It'll be a little different this year. And to remember those things that are important, like young men that are working at home with Dad today. Shawn, there's your little guy. That's great. I want you to remember, even though Remembrance Day will be a bit different, it's still an important thing to remember. And I'll finish with simply this, that like our relatives and friends and neighbors who went to war to protect our rights, they didn't do it alone, and this next evolution or revolution, you don't have to do it alone either. So to all of you, thanks. Have a great Saskatchewan Day, and thanks for being with us. John, Alisha.
Thanks, Steve. That was great. Thank you so much.
Thank you all.